Kasanga, located in the south of Lake Tanganyika, is the location where I shot the images for this video, with the Limbe Beach Resort as my base. During my first diving and snorkeling activities around Kasanga, I noticed a large concentration of Allonocranus dewinti and Callochromis macrops. These two species prefer a shallow intermediate habitats, and these habitats are abundant in the vicinity of the lodge. The lodge was an important export location for cichlids in the earlier years, as evidenced by the brick tanks. A small jetty and a breakwater were built for this export at that time to protect the boats from the high waves. This small bay is therefore an ideal place to start snorkeling activities. Allonocranus dewinti occurs in the shallow intermediate habitats with coarse sand, gravel and some substrate. This bay is in most places not deeper than 1 meter. Dewinti occurs throughout the lake. Male specimens have shiny blue longitudinal stripes and a yellow background. The fins also have this yellow base color. The anal, the chest and the caudal fin are dark in color. There is very little geographical variation in male color pattern, but there is individual variation within populations. The female specimens have a steel gray color. It spends most of its time searching the substrate for food and to care for posterity. The males therefore construct small bowers with a base diameter of 30 to 40 centimeters and an inner bowl, the spawning pit, of about 15 cm, which has the shape of a small crater. These bowers must be in perfect condition. Any small object that ends up in the crater-shaped structure will be removed immediately, so a lot of time is spent building and maintaining these structures. Territorial males entice females to their bowers and lead them by powerful undulating movements of the body. It is likely that the male releases some pheromones while waving on his way back to his bower. Females gather in groups and hover about 50 centimeters above the substrate. With the female a few body lengths behind him, the excited male enters the spawning bowl and probably quickly releases some semen at the bottom. He then immediately vacates the pit before the female arrives and starts depositing a number of eggs. The eggs are fertilized in the spawning pit before being collected by the female. As soon as the female leaves the pit, he tries to entice her back. She may respond to his courtship, but it is more likely that she will leave and visit additional males. A female can produce up to 35 eggs, which allows them to be fertilized by several males. Allonocranus dewinti is found in large breeding colonies, often together with Callochromis macrops. In contrast to the crater-shaped structure of A. dewinti, Callochromis macrops have a cone-shaped structure. C. macrops is a breeder in which males most often construct their bowers on top of rocks or on shallow, sandy and rocky habitats like here. These heaps of sand are usually about 20 to 30 centimeters above the bottom and have a flat spawning platform on top. In general, the males keep a respectful distance of at least 2 meters when building their structures. Just outside the breakwater, the depth drops to approximately 3 meters. And a great diversity of cichlids live on that breakwater. Cichlids from different genera search here for food and protection against the predators. At the bottom of the breakwater slope, where the stones turn into sand, is also a favorite breeding ground for the aforementioned two species. Alaunocranus de Winti belongs to an exclusive group of African cichlids that are commonly known as feather fins, which becomes obvious due to their flowing finnage that has to add to their appeal. In the lake occurs four genera that belong to this exclusive group of feather fins. A. de Winti is the most common feather fin. Alaunocranus de Winti in particular prefers to use stones the size of small footballs in their bowers. They do this to strengthen the bower when they are exposed to the sometimes strong waves. Alaunocranus de Winti and Calogromus macropes have a common preference for intermediate habitat, up to about 8 to 10 meters, often where the bank stones change to sand. To film at that depth, I have to use my diving equipment. I expected the transition to be about 10 to 15 meters from the bank. Searching along the bottom for the transition, I found the first cichlids, and that is not surprising given the large fish stock of Lake Tanganyika. Several brood-carrying couples, some with eggs and others like this Varia bilichromis morii, with a free-swimming offspring. Perisodus strae leini is a threat to every cichlid because this cichlid has evolved its feeding pattern by eating the scales of its fellow inhabitants. The Piscivore Lamprologus lemaerii blends in with its environment to surprise and feed on passing juvenile cichlids. Lepidio Lamprologus Atheniatus is a very common inhabitant of the intermediate habitat. Perisodus paradoxus is possibly the most common scale eater to be found in Lake Tanganyika. The intermediate habitat is also a popular hunting ground for Boulangirochromus microlepis. And personally, I think the transition zone is one of the most beautiful habitats. The genus Callochromus consists of four species of sand-grubbing cichlids found in the shallow water of the lake. The same microbes have a very wide range and are found almost anywhere around the lake, except in the far north. Same microbes breed in breeding colonies, which males most often construct their bowers on top of rocks, or in the shallow rocky sand habitat like here. The male shows the female where to deposit eggs by folding his anal fin in such a manner that a large orange spot on the anal fin resembles an egg in three dimensions, and holding it in the center of the spawning platform. A ripe female responds to the courtship, enters the spawning platform and lays a few eggs. At that moment, the male shows his folded anal fin in front of her mouth, while discharging his milt, which is taken in by the female to fertilize the eggs inside her mouth. Clutch size ranges between 25 and 60 eggs. Mouth brooding females of same microbes as well from A. de Winti gather in nursery schools and stay in the shallow water where they release their offspring either simultaneously or into schools of other juvenile fish. I was also curious how these cichlids behave during the night. Therefore, I planned a night snorkel as well. I had already prepared my underwater equipment for this in the afternoon. My plan was to get into the water just before sunset, knowing that the sun will disappear quickly, causing darkness to fall quickly. But hopefully left alone by the crocodiles, which are sometimes spotted in the lake. In Lake Tanganyika, huge numbers of shrimps come out to feed on phytoplankton at night. And several cichlid species feed on them during the night. A. de Winti is one such species and uses his enhanced sonar system to detect prey under very subdued light conditions. The fish loses most of its dark coloration and appears very pale at night. It floats in the water column, listening to the movements of the tiny shrimps hopping around. When a shrimp comes close to his mouth, it is quickly sucked inside. Callochromus microbes does not have that eating pattern during the night. But most species, such as Trophaeus and Petrochromus, have sought out the rocky habitats for protection against possible predators. And during the night, you will find predators everywhere. Crabs are, in general, scavengers, but will certainly take the chance to surprise an unwary sleeping cichlid. Several species of the spiny eel Mastacembalus also occur in the lake. And these eels also feed on small cichlids. Larger species of the spiny eels are cannibals and therefore do not hesitate to eat each other. I think one of the most predatory fish at night is the African electric catfish, Melapterurus tangaicaensis, who in this situation has laid down in a bower to electroduce possibly swimming in Aulonocranus adventii, which will thereby become paralyzed and which will then be consumed. A beautiful species, but as I mentioned it, a dangerous predator. Early the next morning, I tried to catch some cichlids with my net. I was able to entangle several species in my net, but unfortunately not one of the cichlids discussed earlier, with the exception of a female of Aulonocranus adventii. I took a few species to shore to show them to you in my photo cuvette. Several species that occur in large numbers, mainly in the shallow areas, with the last being the female of Aulonocranus adventii.